Welcome back to CAFC, the Charlton all-time fantasy 11 club. I am your host, Sam White, and it has been a really depressing Christmas, guys. This is the safe space. This is the place where it's okay to be a Charlton supporter. We can talk about the good old times, the playoff final, the quality shirts. Mr. Charlton, who's that going to be this week? I'd probably say it about 100 times. But today's guest is someone who brings a lot of joy, a lot of big smiles, and a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of glamour, shall we say. And it's none other than fantastic Miss Charlotte Richardson. I was delighted to get her on. It was actually the week we'd played Gillingham. So it's a bit of a Richardson derby, that one. We'll get into that in the podcast. We also get into how she found Charlton, who brought her to Charlton, who what she does around the club, and what it's like working with Brownie and Kurbishley on a sort of regular basis, and what it's like dealing with Scott Minto as well. She does a few different jobs around the club, and it's been fascinating talking to her about it, as well as some work with TalkSport I wasn't aware of. So all that chat is just coming up. Hope you enjoy it. Some players who's chose have been a bit, let's just say this girl knows where her bread's buttered. There's definitely some of these choices that aren't getting in just on quality alone. But that's a beautiful thing about this show. So sit back, enjoy, and until the next game, this is a little bit of a breathing space, a chance to enjoy some good stuff. And let me welcome the fantastic Miss Charlotte Richardson.
Hello, welcome back to CAFC, the Charlton all-time fantasy 11 club. Yes, that is difficult to squeeze into CAFC, but I did it. We have got a fantastic guest with us today. I'm so excited because I've said it 100 times. The best thing that's come out of Charlton in the last 5 or 6 years has been Charlton TV. We are so lucky as a club to have that format. I mean, what other club gets to talk to one of the longest serving English Premier League managers once a week about their club? We're so lucky to have that. And today we've got someone who brings a lot of professionalism, a little bit of glamour. I would say, no, it isn't Steve Brown. It is a fantastic Charlotte Richardson. Let me bring you in. Welcome, Charlotte. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm very well, thanks. I'm really, really well. Thank you for that lovely introduction. And I have to say how nice it is whenever I get the opportunity to meet fans, or fans come over for a chat and they talk about Charlton TV the way that you have just done, because I completely agree and it's an absolute privilege to be a part of. It's a lot of good fun as well, as I'm sure you can imagine.
It looks like so much fun. And as a fan, you know, we came out of the Premiership and then suddenly there's no coverage. And I've got fans that support Palace, Man United, and literally all you have to do is open a paper or put on Instagram and there's going to be 100 things about their club. So where do you go? And Charlton TV is really, it's the highlight of the week and I love it so much. So thank you. And please pass on all the good vibes and messages to the rest of the team, because it doesn't look like it's kind of, it looks so much fun and you're having a great time, but it doesn't look like it's always really easy. You got Kevin Lisby turning up 10 minutes late. Kerbs is always moaning about the Blackpool Tunnel. It doesn't look like it's always an easy job. How is it to do it? And how did you, sorry, I'm going to ask you 100 questions all in one go. How is it to do it? And what came first? What was it, chicken and egg? What was it, your love for Charlton, or was it Charlton TV? And you've sort of learned to love us over the last couple of years.
No, the love definitely came first for Charlton. I'm born and raised in Southeast London. My mum's side of the family grew up in the area. My granddad was a lifelong Charlton fan, and my grand's cousin played for the club. So I always tell people very, very early on, I have to put the disclaimer in that I grew up in a red and blue household, which is quite apt given that I think next weekend Gillingham are playing Charlton. So that's the blue side of me. My dad was a Gillingham fan. So I spent kind of all my childhood torn limb by limb by dad and granddad. But living where I do, you couldn't not have the sort of touch print of Charlton Athletic. And that's not only because I grew up through sort of that successful generation getting into the Premier League, but because of the club's incredible community trust, which I'm really lucky I get to support nowadays. And it was always around. It was the club that was the only club that young girls play football. So every half term I was at their community camps, soccer schools, playing, and then again growing up following the men's team in a more limited way, but every single season, and for about five in a row, I think, if I'm not mistaken, Charlton Athletic were always in the FA Women's Cup final. And it was like Christmas Day. It was only one day of the year where you'd see women's football on your TV, and I'd be with granddad, we'd be watching. And it's so strange to think about it now and what I'm doing now, and the fact that pretty much every weekend you can watch the WSL. But honestly, it was this mythical thing, and Charlton, I just took it for granted that the Charlton and success and getting to finals came hand in hand. So long story short, the love of the football club was always there. And I've worked in football my whole career. It's always sort of in the marketing media side of it, but pivoted and focused more on broadcasting in the last 2 years. And it was just through dropping an email to someone that I knew worked for Charlton and sort of saying to her that the COVID season had just finished and I was doing a lot of commentary work for BBC Radio Kent. And anyone that sort of works in this industry will tell you that the best experience you can get is the practice. And COVID was a very odd scenario to make your debut as a commentator, because you've got no atmosphere to build off, but your listenership is quite high because local radio was, again, one of the few channels able to report at the time. And I just didn't want to lose the momentum. I just wanted to keep practicing. I just wanted to keep learning. So I reached out to her and said, look, if there's anything going on, I'd love to actually just volunteer my time. Lo and behold, I think the club were having a look at Charlton TV. They were wanting to grow it. This was when the previous ownership were in charge, and you know, to their credit, they really, you know, they really prioritised Charlton TV. So I had a meeting with the club, was given a very bizarre debut, and it will be a bizarre debut when I, you know, tell my children's children or whatever. But it was the vaccination at the Valley event. I don't know if anyone.
Amazing thing.
I was chucked in terms of like go pitch side, interview people, and we'll see how you get on. So I was having to wear a face mask, try and build a rapport with people. It was very, very strange. And then I was given a month's trial. And as they say, the rest is sort of history. It's grown from doing the pitch side announcing to, I think my first interview, I got a kind of text message. I think it was the Papa John's Trophy saying, do you want to interview the manager afterwards? And I was like, yes, please. And then it's grown and grown and grown. And then one day Scott wasn't able to make a game and they offered me the opportunity. And now I sort of happily step in whenever Scott's either on holiday or elsewhere. And I absolutely love it.
It must be so much fun. And it really does sound, I had the same sort of conversation with Greg where, you know, we're known for sort of our academy, bringing players up through the squad. It sounds like that on the media side of things as well, where it's just a case of, you know, if you're around the club, if you're involved, you do get an opportunity, which is an amazing thing. I'm so glad as well when you said it was a red and blue household. It wasn't Palace. It was Gillingham. That's where my head went straight away. But that's amazing. So how did your kind of do you remember sort of first games or anything like that? Or was it kind of all a bit of a Gillingham Charlton blur?
It's a bit of a Gillingham Charlton blur. My dad took me to Priestfield. I know it was Priestfield. And I was about sort of 7, 8 years old. And I'm pretty sure that Bob Taylor scored for Gillingham. But I was besotted with the atmosphere. I think it's fair to say that I was not a glory hunter by any
stretch. No.
It definitely taught me sort of how to overcome adversity and, you know, deal with disappointment, because I know that Charlton fans will feel that we concede a lot of late goals, perhaps, but Gillingham just made a lifelong childhood memory of it. But it was going into the crowd and it was hearing the chants. It was the, you know, the smell of the onions frying and you know, almost like you can't really describe why certain players are your favourite players, but you know, being besotted with the sort of the movement, the passion. You know, I went to the Wembley final and had my heart broken. Then Gillingham were 2-0 up after 90 minutes. And then it went into extra time and Manchester City won. And now look where they are. And but similarly, I remember going to the FA Cup game between Gillingham and Charlton and sitting in the Charlton end with Grandad. So Grandad obviously had his sway there. Yeah. And Gillingham pulled off what was an upset at the time. It was a 3-2 victory, I think. So the other thing now, again, being brutally honest with you, Sam, is the number of games that go on. I can barely remember like the Charlton result. I'm prepping for the game on Saturday and I'm thinking, right, where are we at again? Or, you know, we had Cray and now we have Sutton and now we have, there are so many competitions and my memory isn't the best of the best times. So this is going to be interesting.
Yeah.
sudden lapses of my memory. But I think for me, it's always been the emotion. It's been about how football has made me feel. And even when there are moments where it doesn't make you feel the best, I think that's all part and parcel of it and why we're all so infatuated with our clubs.
It's just, it's something you can't get rid of. And, you know, having two clubs growing up with that, I don't, so is your granddad, your dad's dad?
No, granddad, so mum's side is right. Charlton, dad's side is Gillingham. And right. So, yeah, unfortunately, my granddad passed away before I ever got involved with Charlton TV. Oh, but no. I just know that he would be so thrilled. And my gran, she randomly actually last night, I saw her and she was asking me all about Cray Valley because again that's where our roots are, and she was right. Like, oh, I've got a soft spot for them. And I was like, oh, do you, Gran? Like, she never really talks all that much to me about football, but it's kind of again those Southeast London roots that have always been a part of me growing up, and you know why Charlton was always a result that I followed, and particularly in the Premier League years was so envious and tried to say to my granddad, look, how can you be upset? You're in the Premier League, like we're in League One or League Two.
I think I've realised that it doesn't matter if you're losing to Man City or Manchester United away, or if you're losing to Cray or drawing with Cray. It feels the same. It hurts as much, and that's the, you know, when we first dropped down to the Championship after being in the Premier League for such a long time, I was like, do you know what? I was probably 17, 18. Do you know what? We're going to win a lot of games. We'll win a lot of games next year. I remember, you know, when we went up from the playoff final and then went down, we won. We went up as champions and it was great. Winning games feels good and losing games feels bad, no matter who you're playing against. The thing that hurts is what kind of happened. So like just before you joined and Charlton TV kicked off, it was the thought of not having a club. And I just had my daughter. I was like, we might not have a club in 6 months' time. Where am I going to take her? I'm going to have to take her to Gillingham or Palace because that doesn't feel right. And that's the difference. That's where it feels you can feel genuinely hurt and betrayed by someone who has come into the club, an ownership that doesn't necessarily have that heart and soul. And you feel like this, they're just there for the money. And God love them. I mean, the board seems to be making some good moves at the moment, and we brought in some great players on deadline day. But like we saw with the last ownership and the ownership before that, it's their plaything. It can be. It can be up to them what they do with it, and it's their money. They can just rip your kind of what your identity out of you, and you have to go somewhere else. So no, Charlton TV is definitely the thing that I think has really brought the fans and the club the fans and the club together in a time where it was really difficult, because that must be quite intimidating, being sat opposite, you know, Brownie, Kerbishley, players that have got such a long-standing relationship with the club. Do you ever feel like you're sat in that chair, like, does it feel a bit intimidating? Is there that side of it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, particularly that those first few occasions when you're stepping into Phil Scott's shoes, you know, you feel a massive weight of responsibility, and you wanted to, you know, you want to deliver an experience that people are going to enjoy. But I think for me, I had to sort of accept early on that I was going to bring something a little bit different, because I'm not an ex-teammate. I'm not a former professional footballer. So all I have to do is be myself, and just, you know, I have my own individual rapport and relationships with the guys. So, and not many people know this, but I've actually known Brownie for at least 5 years, because I used to work at Margate Football Club where he was assistant manager. We used to sit on, and he was director of football there, and I used to sometimes sit on board meetings, and we always got on very, very well.
You do have a really natural chemistry
I love Brownie. What I will say about Brownie is you will not meet a more, you know, you were talking about sometimes your football club and owners and that trust, like Brownie is one of the most authentic, values driven person. You know, he's got such a sense of what's right and his honesty. And you know, when I did have those first sort of trial games and those first interviews, I think whether he did it subconsciously or not, he made sure that I was really, really comfortable. And he both and Scott as well have always been on hand. Like, if you want any advice, if you need anything, just let me know. And I actually went and shadowed Scott before going into the studio, because like you alluded to it, there's a lot more going on than people perhaps and realize, and I wouldn't want them to realize that, because yeah. you're putting on your Charlton TV, and you know, people might see that Scott and I were wearing earpiece, so we have a director in our ear throughout, but we want it to flow like we're sat in the pub, or you know, we're sat in your living room with you. So it was definitely daunting. And I think sometimes working in broadcasting can be quite a daunting thing, because ultimately you're sort of exposing yourself, you know, whether that's by posing questions or presenting, you know, you're putting your character out there and your personality out there, and just hoping that people enjoy your style of doing things. But I think ultimately it comes down to that point of authenticity. And I love the football club, want the football club to do well. And I think, again, when the cameras aren't rolling, all of us, you know, we have cheered so loudly when Charlton have scored. We've also been really upset when we might have conceded, or feel like, you know, little moments have let us down. We really do live and breathe it. And I think that's what makes it such a fantastic production. And every guest that we have, particularly when we went through a phase last season of having lots of club legends come on, yeah. It's the thread that I've interviewed so many people in my time at Charlton, so many club legends, and you hear the same things constantly. And it's why those players always love coming back to the club. And it makes my job easy, because I'm working with fantastic people.
I mean, I really believe you, and I completely see what you're saying. My concern is that I think that most people feel the same things about their club, that, you know, it's all about the, you know, the man on the street, it's all about the fans. But it really does feel, especially when you see players like Miles Eburn coming through, and he's got Tracy there, and his dad played for the club, and Curbs is, you know, it really does have that genuine feel about it. And I'm sure it does for, you know, clubs up and down the country. You know, everyone's going to have those ties with certain players and certain stories. But I do think things are a little bit special with Charlton, at least it does seem to be. And you know, fingers crossed that's good ownership, but it's mainly just good people being around the club and staying there and wanting the best for the club. And I think that's why we're so lucky. But you came on to my big questions. Can you give us the dirt? What goes on behind the scenes? Who brings the snacks in? What where does Brownie get his shirts from?
Brownie's wardrobe.
I can't believe you've got a director there and someone's not going, mate, come on, have a look at yourself. Let's have a
he gets so much stick, bless him. But he usually got some to me. And also I know he's thrown a bit of shade my way in terms of my own record in the studio. So but one thing I would say is that, so we, for those that don't know, we record Charlton TV in one of the boxes up in the Alan Kirbishley stand. So it's always a bit of a workout to get to the top anyway. You've got to come up a lot of flight of stairs. And I tend to get there first, obviously, to rehearse and go through, and the guys will join me. But it's like this little microclimate, this box. Like on my first game of the season, it was like a heat wave. It was so unbearably hot in there that Brownie had to go and watch the game outside. And then I've also seen WhatsApp messages of like, well, I know it's freezing cold as well. So it's its own little microclimate, which is fun. So you can imagine like everyone kind of bowls in and the snacks in the past. I mean, I know Brownie's bought sushi, and that's never happened on my watch, unfortunately. But we are like, we're quite a bougie bunch. Like we get peckish, we need sustenance, and we're really lucky that the club actually help us out a bit, and they go and do a snack run for us. So the last game I did was a Tuesday night game, and we basically, like, I got to learn a lot about Brownie's. Like, what was Brownie's? He went for like some really bougie beef sandwich. Curbs and I both got prawn sandwiches, which is very like synonymous. Wow. The prawn sandwich brigade.
Yeah.
But lots of like sugar and coffee that goes into behind the scenes. And one thing I've always said to the club as well is that I've seen like episodes of Charlton TV where like food's been sent in, or they got to do like do you remember the Upbeats burger?
Yeah.
I'm always saying like, guys, can I do like one of the food things? I wanted to go to Oktoberfest when that was on at the club. But to be honest,
I've never seen anyone more disgusted when they brought in the vegan burgers for Brownie. He was not on board with that at all. My wife's a vegan, so I'm experienced. I know that vegan food is great. They were not impressed with that at all.
Well, Curbs always brings over pies. So if he goes and does like an interview in the Charlton TV lounge before, he'll always bring the pies over, which, you know, again, you know, he's King Curbs for a reason, isn't he? He always makes sure that we're well looked after. But, you know, really and truly, like, I get there about half past, well, I get to the club at about 12 and do the pre-match interviews, and I'm in the studio by about 1 o'clock. Before I know it, it's half five, and it all just goes so, so quickly. And we have a bit of a laugh as well amongst it all, which is good, because sometimes we've needed it.
Well, that's my next question.
We've needed it.
Yeah, how do you do that? How do you get on screen? You know, before the show, I can imagine it's really good. You know, you've got this and this lined up, and we've got this guest on, we're doing this, blah, 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 all planned out. If the game is awful and absolute rubbish, how hard is it then to get some enthusiasm? And I guess this is where the professionalism comes in, and this is why we're so good at your job. But how hard is it to kind of get the guys going, right, we've got to give some sort of positive spin on this, or give us something? Yeah.
You're spot on. You've kind of identified there like the biggest challenge of all. And it hasn't happened too often, but there was a Good Friday game last season, springs out. This is where, again, my memory just is absolutely atrocious. I want to say, it was definitely an away game, but it was 0-0 at half time, and it was just a really, really poor game of football. There was nothing in the way of, like, I don't think either team had really had a shot on target, and that was really, really hard. But I think it just is, I suppose, you what I will do is I have my earpiece in and I have my mic in, so as the 45 minutes is unfolding, if there are patterns of play, if there are key incidents, I will talk to the guys that are directing. So they're based in a sort of van outside of the valley in the car parks. Supporters might see it if they come into the ground that way, and I'll talk to them and say, right, can we clip up that little bit, and we'll do like a little monologue on Corey Blackett Taylor, for example. Or you know, if there's been a handball incident or a penalty call, or Brownie might spot something, you know, because Brownie's tactical knowledge is absolutely superb. So we'll maybe lean on the tactical side a little bit more. But I do remember that Good Friday game was hard, because it was just a strange game where there was, you know, I think it was against another team who had very little to play for, and it was just a very vanilla game. So you do prefer the games where you do have a little bit more to talk about, goals galore, which is great. And it's brilliant as well when the stuff that you talk about then comes to fruition. That's a really satisfying feeling.
I can imagine. And I guess that can be either way. I guess the last thing you want, like you said, is just a dull 0-0. Even if we're playing really badly, at least you've got something to kind of explore and why we're doing it. But in those times, like you said, tactically, Brownie seems amazing. Obviously, you've got Kirby there, who's, you know, king of football. I've sat there with my dad going, can't they just go down to the dugout and tell them, can't they go down to the changing room now and tell them this? Why, like, don't waste it on us. Don't waste it on the fans. Get down there. And how hard is it? And I'm probably asking you a question I need to ask them. How hard is it for them to keep that, you know, professionalism and not go, right, I am going to, someone needs to have a word, or I need to speak to someone, or I've got some, I'm imagining they've got contacts at the club and that sort of thing.
Yeah, do you know what, they're both really, really professional people and very passionate people. And I actually think it's relatively easy. I think what sometimes supporters might not understand or empathise with is, you know, we are a club production, so we tread a line. You know, it's not TalkSport, it's not the BBC. Like, we have to tread that line of, you know, providing analysis, but doing it in a, you know, a really respectful way, and perhaps being mindful of things that aren't necessarily in the public domain. I don't know, like, there's just that sort of edge to it that I'm always conscious of, and I know that Brownie and Curbs are as well. And there's definitely been times where there's, you know, there's been off camera, like, a lot of displays, because they both care, you know. And if there's things that they can see that, you know, could have been avoided. I know at the start of the season there are a couple of games where there are some really, really avoidable goals. You know, they show that passion, but what they're both really, really good at is then I suppose it's from their careers, both being professional players and managers, is you take that emotion and then they articulate it in the way that they both do so, so well.
Yeah.
And then give us the perspective that is why we tune in. You know, I always say the best co-commentators that I work with, the best pundits, they tell me something I don't know. You know, it can be very easy to poke holes at individuals or, you know, finger point. But for me as a presenter, I want to elevate that discussion, and I want to bring out in them things that I don't necessarily see because I'm not a UEFA A licensed or pro licensed coach. You know, when I have the pleasure of sitting down with them, and again, I'm like a sponge and I'm listening and I'm saying to Brownie, and I might say something and goes, yeah, look at this. You know, those conversations help teach me so much. Yeah. And one thing I'll say as well, we had Jason Pearce in the studio once, and I noticed that when he was in, he was like a sponge with Curbs. He asked Curbs so many questions.
Yeah.
I felt like he really used that opportunity to learn. And I just thought that was really interesting as well. And it was a signal into like what a good manager Jason Pearce is going to become one day, because he uses opportunities like that to develop his knowledge. So to answer your question, I think they find it quite easy, but rest assured, and I think it's very clear that the passion is there.
You can tell. And I think it's a massive compliment to you that, you know, that thing about not being a Sky or not being TalkSport, it looks great. The punditry is brilliant. The analysis you guys do is fantastic. Sometimes the video clips aren't quite as neat and tidy as you want them to be, but there's nothing there that you think, right, I'm not watching a professional product. It does feel like watching your team on Sky Sports every week, which is dream come true for me. I can never not watch it. And the only thing every time a new manager comes in, I think Holden was quite vocal about, you know, you've got two guys sitting there who, you know, been there, seen it, done it. And I don't want to embarrass myself about that against them. I'm sure it goes on, but you hope that the managers that do come in are, you know, talking to Curbs, talking to Brownie and saying, you know, what have you seen? And getting their experience. But obviously that's how each different manager does it. And that's, mm-hmm. I'm imagining that they make themselves available if they want to be, but they don't overdo it, if you know what I mean. But that's a lovely thing that we've got there. So we're going to get into your team now. Like you said, it's been, and I can see you've made a couple of very, let's say, you know where your bread's buttered. There's a couple of very diplomatic choices here, shall we say. I mean, some of these players haven't even been in the conversation before, but should we start with your goalkeeper? Let's start with him, because that's a pretty much nailed on choice for everyone, I think.
Yeah, so it had to be Sam Bartram.
To win the FA Cup, and he still holds the record for the number of appearances with 623 matches for the London club.
Sam Bartram is our most famous player. That's why he has a statue outside the ground. He's still the record holder for having made the most appearances for the club, over 600 appearances, and that would have been even more if all the appearances he made during World War II, which don't count, were included. So he probably actually played for the club over 800 times.
Yeah, it had to be him, Sam, because one of the things that I love most about my job sometimes is the sort of walk into the valley. And, you know, I walk past his statue every time I come into the ground. But one of the things I love most is like the little pockets of conversations that you pick up around his statue. Like, I feel like it's the place people meet on a match day, you know, see you at Bartram's. And I just love the atmosphere and the legacy that is built off of the back of a player like that. And players like him have not existed in the last few decades, and they won't ever again because of the way the modern game is. But to be a one club man, it's just, you know, that football romantic in me misses that way, and that way the club was. And again, you made a really good point about it seems like people that have played for the club love coming back to the club. That's not something that happens overnight. It's very much the DNA dating back to that sort of Bartram era. I think we do a really good job in honouring players who have shown commitment and given a lot to the football club. So that for me was, you know, a really obvious choice. And it's just, again, one of the things I love on a Saturday or Tuesday evening, just kind of walking past, giving him a nod, and thinking, right, what have we got in store for the next 90 minutes?
It really does feel like that bit of heritage, doesn't it? And I mean, he's got 800 appearances that the guy from, I've forgotten his name, sorry, but I ripped that from the museum archive. 579 official appearances. There's the great stories about him in the fog against Chelsea getting left out on the pitch. But my thing is, what a great head of hair that guy had. It was unbelievable. I mean, that statue, he's phenomenal. He's a big, good-looking guy. So, yeah, we've done well. I mean, in terms of having a bar named after you, the statue outside, and when you hear his daughter and stuff talking on the pitch, I remember she was on doing, I think they did an award a couple of years ago. I mean, he just seems like the nicest guy in the world. And like you said, it will be rare for someone like that to come along again. You've had it with Steven Gerrard, and I think he's the only player in English football I can remember that's done it. We have had players that I've thought, you know, like we're going to come on to one of your midfielders later, and he's 100% picked so far. Scott Parker, you do wonder, where would that guy be if he had have just been a one-club man? Where would we have gone? Because, you know, we were competing for Europe at the time. But, yeah, the chance of that happening again is probably... I can't see it happening again.
And that's what I really find fascinating about football as well. And when you spend a lot of time working around elite football environments, you sort of learn a lot more and you're privy to things that you wouldn't normally be if you are a supporter. And I think one of the things I always like to be as an interviewer is empathetic, because I actually realise that whilst it's the best profession in the world to be a footballer, there are so many little crossroads and choices and little moments can prove to be so significant to a career's player and a player's career.
Yeah, yeah.
And, the Scott Parker example was one of them. Like, how could that career have gone? And those decisions can have a massive, massive impact. And it's perhaps not something I like about the modern game as much in terms of, and we're going to come on to one of my players a bit later on, but for a player to rack up 100 appearances plus now is a real, real rarity. And like I say, I'm a bit of an old school romantic, and I just think it's harder now for players to be club legends. Or, you know, Jordan Henderson, for example, like if I was a Liverpool supporter, that legacy for me is tainted by his decision to go and play in Saudi Arabia. So, you know, the modern game now doesn't have that romantic, nostalgic sense of like some of the players that are in the squad here that signed for a club, were happy at a club and would stay at a club.
Mm. I think the two things I didn't realise when I was, you know, 6, 7, 8, growing up and watching my heroes is, one, players don't often get to choose where they live. You go to a club, and some players, we've seen it with Paul Mullen and Wrexham. He moved to Wrexham. Yes, you know, there's a big fame thing there, but he moved to Wrexham because that's where he's close to where his home was. And you think, I get that from certain players, why you would choose to play for a club that's nearer your home when you've been away all your life. The other thing is, you're a long time retired. Like, if most players retire around 31, 32, I mean, Henderson could have probably wouldn't have been a mainstay in the Liverpool lineup this year, next year. He's going to earn a lot of money there. And I get it from that side as well. And they're the things that you just don't take into consideration when you're 8 years old and you've got a player's name on your back. Like Miles Lieber, and we know that he can play levels above where he is at the moment. He's got such good ties with the club. But if we get offered 4 or 5 million for him and he's going and playing for a Championship or a Premier League team, you have to kind of hold your hands up and go, that could make sense. But luckily, I've never been good enough to make those decisions, so it's not a problem for me. Let's go into the offence. So you've got four across the line. Who do you want to go for first?
Let's go for my left back. And as you mentioned, I know where my bread is buttered, and there are a few individuals that, if they were not included in this starting 11, I might be facing early retirement from Charlton TV. So it is, of course, Scotty Minto. Classy guy off the pitch, classy guy on it as well. You know, I know that Charlton means so much to him because it was the club that handed him his debut. And I guess this 11 might not be the most tactically astute team. It's certainly a blend of characters and personalities. But again, in terms of how Scott has impacted me and my career, I'm so fortunate enough to work with him on Charlton TV, but also for TalkSport. And I think he is an incredible broadcaster who has made that transition from playing to doing what he does now impeccably and flawlessly. So, you know, he was an absolute one of the first names on the team sheet.
He's unbelievable. I mean, to think that he was with Sky Sports and doing like and one of their main guys only a couple of years ago, and then doing exactly the same job. There was no drop off of quality. If anything, he kind of it seemed like he came more alive because he's got more relationships with Curbs and that kind of thing. It gives us so much credibility when you've got someone like that there, just, you know, holding everything together. I mean, you say he hasn't been mentioned as a left back in terms of, you know, how much he played. That's because people have either gone for Chris Powell, more modern. He still had 180 appearances and scored 7 goals. We saw a couple of them there. How like you said, he's always on hand. You've got him available all the time. How glad are you when he goes on holiday, though? Is that kind of like...
Well, particularly in the colder months, so yeah. I don't have to get rained on pitch side because... Yeah, again, for those of who are listening that don't know, so if I'm not in the studio, I do pitch side announcing. So I'm kind of based in between the two dugouts, which is quite fascinating, really, because you get to hear it all. And particularly the 4-4 against Ipswich when Ben Garner got sent off, you know, that was the best seat in the house. It was incredible. And likewise, the Brighton penalty shootout springs to mind. So, you know, most times absolutely love being down there, but I'm covering the next 2 games for him. And it is getting colder, Sam. So, you know... I mentioned about it being chilly in the studio, but at least it's a little bit toastier up there and I can have some sandwiches and whatever snacks Brownie brings in. But no, in all seriousness, it's like I say, it's a pleasure. It's an honour. It's a responsibility that I take really seriously. And he, you know, I think hopefully, when we do sort of switch between the two of us, it hopefully just flows in a way that the experience hopefully isn't, you know, too much worse when you're watching me, hopefully.
Honestly, can I tell you, and I wanted to say this from the beginning, when I first saw you on screen, I was like, I don't know, I've never heard this person before. It flowed so nicely all the way through. And I think in a way, you kind of asked more questions that we would ask than an ex-player would ask as well. And that for me is like, you're more of an insight and... I wouldn't say you connect more with the fans than Scott does because you both do it in different ways, but it does feel like you're more from the fan side rather than an ex-player side. So it does feel like there's a really good connection. And like I said, it feels like you're asking the questions that I would want to ask. So no, not at all. It's always great. It's a great watch, whoever's on, which is lucky. We're just lucky to have you guys, I think. And it's turning into a bloody good looking 11. I mean, Scott, Sam, they're both good-looking boys. Who have you gone for across? Who do you want to go for next across them?
Well, on that note, I've got to say Steve Brown.
9 minutes remaining. Charlton down to 10 men, and with an outfield player in goal. He did well enough on a previous occasion, immediately facing the free kick and making a good save. Churchin blocked, didn't know too much about it, away by Powell. Well, it's a good save by Brown.
Oh, I love that man.
I could see your face while that was playing, and the love in your eyes for Steve Brown is
just, and the amount of times I've heard about that as well. prowess, but no, honestly, everything you want Charlton Athletic to be, you know, the values you would want your football club to be are epitomized by that man. And you know, I could never say it to his face, his head wouldn't get out the studio door, but you know, he's 100% commitment. He's a good laugh. His knowledge is second to none. And I'm just absolutely blessed to work with him. I don't think it matters whether he's in the studio or whether he's providing commentary or in one of the lounges. You know, he's such a multifaceted character. There's so much depth to him. that I, you know, I've had the fortune of working with him in many different circumstances and in many different ways. And I always learn something new every time I work with him, or I pick up something. And like, I think I said to you, mentioned earlier, like watch a game with him and he will show you things. Like he will just see things before they happen. And you just, yeah, like I say, you just learn a lot. And I think he adds real benefit to the production of Charlton TV, because, you know, when he's with Scott and Curbs, you know, he's got those stories. He can share like the hilarious moments that, you know, built that team spirit of the squads that he was a part of that achieved monumental things. But also, and again, how I like to delve into it is the detail around the tactics, and there is, you know, nothing he doesn't know. So he's absolutely brilliant. And I think who else, whether it's in goal, you know, so I've got versatility in my team. Yeah, you know, he's just someone that you just know would play anywhere for Charlton Athletic. He would do a job anywhere on the pitch. And I think it's a shame that he suffered, you know, the injuries. And I know that his knee to this day gives him, you know, real problems. And I actually just think that is almost a bit of a consequence of how hard he battled on the the pitch. So he had to absolutely be in my 11.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, again, he's not a bad shout in general, even if you aren't just looking at, you know, saving face when you next see him. 242 appearances and 9 goals from centre back. He also scored the second penalty in the playoff final. What I realised, I went to an audience with Alan Kirbishley. They hosted it a couple of years ago. When you had Chris Powell, I think, was there, Johnny Jackson. Loads of club legends, but the biggest reaction from the fans, and the only one who got a song sung when he got brought on stage, was Steve Brown. I think he does, when he's sitting there as a pundit, or whether he was on the commentary, it feels like he's an extension of the fans. Like he sees it as a fan, but also with this wealth of experience. And the interview he did with ModMag on their podcast, when you realise like the job he did when he was a manager, when he was driving up and down and signing players and meeting them and then planning for the tactics, he there's nothing in football that guy hasn't done. And like you said, we're kind of blessed to have him there available to us. And again, I just hope that the management team, whoever's in charge, the coaches, whoever, you know that they've got that resource there. Do you think he will go back into management? Again, I'm asking you questions you probably can't answer, but do you think he's got any ambitions to go back into that side of it?
I mean, I hope I'm not sort of, speaking out of turn. I think he's been quite public in that he loves the sort of coach player development role. And that was one point I wanted to make, actually, is not only is he an incredible tactician and would offer any dugout in the country, whatever level, and I'm talking Prem, like he would be an asset in any management team. Is a lot of the work that he did with Brighton when he was there, developing individual talented players. From our conversations with him, that's what gives him, you know, a really big kick. That's a real, you know, satisfying thing for him, is that ability to work. And because I think also, you know, the realities of working in modern day football is it's absolutely brutal. It's hard to stomach, you know, it's hard for us as supporters. It's hard for us when we have an affinity with the club. And, you know, you mentioned about how he's a reflection of the fans. I think if you speak to any of us that work for Charlton TV, we want to be a conduit between the club and the supporter. And, you know, sometimes that's really, really easy when you've won 4-0 or you're on a fantastic unbeaten run. Other times that's harder. But you lean on that passion and you lean on that experience that you've got within the game. So I think Brownie could do and be whatever he wanted to be. I think he could make a first-class manager at any level if he wanted to. I'm not sure if he does. I think he'd be brilliant in any setup. And I also think he's one of the best co-commentators around. And I'm just flabbergasted that I don't hear him more on mainstream media, because I think, again, when I listen to him, he's just absolutely fantastic. And I don't think people should underestimate how hard commentary and co-coms is either. To speak, and knowing that when you are speaking, particularly as a co-coms, it's got to add value. And he does that so well for Charlton TV and the other broadcasters he works for. So yeah, we're very, very lucky to have him. And I think any supporter would want him in their starting 11, because like I say, if you know, he bleeds Charlton. If you want Charlton DNA personified, that's Steve Brown.
Yeah, 100%. And I promised I wouldn't get emotional, but I can feel it happening already. Okay. Do you want to go for your next centre-back?
Yeah, so I think this would make a really decent centre-back pairing. And my other centre-back is Casey Stoney.
On it. Important. Oh, he was flat there, but it's back in the move, back on her feet. And now Stoney! And the captain just rounds things off.
That's brilliant. The centre-half finishing like a centre-forward, that's great technique. You should be pleased there. England captain, great work by Karen Carney down that left-hand side, but England captain, she's watching everybody else have a go and she thinks, I've got to go up there and have a go myself. And instead of the great ball in, sees Casey Stoney. And that's great technique, bottom corner, that's how it's done.
Yeah, that's not bad for a centre-back, right? She could finish as well. But yeah, I wanted to include Casey Stoney because I think, again, a captain, a leader, I sort of, I really like centre-backs. Centre-backs are really important for me. And on Charlton TV, we talk a lot about the sort of the triangle of the goalkeeper centre-back partnerships. I think it's absolutely fundamental for any side to be successful. And if you can keep that consistent, you're going to build success. But I mean, as captain of Charlton, you know, that was the, they were the glory years. She was the first captain to lead us to an FA Cup final. We won so much silverware during that time. And then, you know, not every club's football history is as glossy and as lovely as we'd like it to be. And I felt like it was appropriate to have Casey in the team as well, because it brings to the forefront of how disappointing it was when the Charlton women's team was absolutely thriving. She was captain, England internationals, and a whole plethora of talent, success at the highest level. It was the first thing to go when the men's team got relegated. So, you know, I don't think I could come on a podcast like this and not reflect that part of our history and that, you know, what a missed opportunity. I get the circumstances and stuff like that. But again, it's like one of those what if moments that we were speaking about earlier, you know, those tough, tough decisions that I wouldn't want to have to make, but absolutely fantastic footballer, technically gifted centre-back, hard as nails, and is now doing really, really well in her coaching. And I wouldn't be surprised if she one day becomes the England Lionesses manager and we can say that she had her roots at Charlton.
It's and she was quite outspoken about that, wasn't she, in terms of, you know, and of course, why wouldn't you be? I mean, it, one good thing that the last ownership did was reinstating the Charlton ladies team, and we're seeing the results of that now. I have to say, it is a blind spot for me, and that's something that I'm learning more, because my daughter's now four. She's going to be four next week. I want to get her more involved in football. We're so lucky to have the coverage that wasn't there for years and years and years. I'm glad that we've got a local team and a national team that's actually getting that exposure. I mean, she had 130 appearances for England and six goals. As a centre-back, that's incredible. Where do you see her in terms of getting involved? I know she isn't. Where is she coaching now? And what,
she's at San Diego. So she's doing really, really well in the United States. So she her first coaching role as a manager was head coach at Manchester United. So she got them promoted from the Championship into the Women's Super League, which was a tough gig at the time because Manchester United didn't have a women's team for so, so long. And then she had the responsibility of basically that pressure, that expectation, and she did really, really well. And then she made the switch to go up to San Diego. And I think the US has always been a country that, in terms of their elite provision through to the grassroots for women and girls football, has been advanced for so many years. But credit to the English FA, it's covered and caught up a lot in a short space of time, to the point that I think if a club was to get relegated from the Premier League now, they wouldn't be in the position that Charlton found themselves at the time in terms of having to cull that part. So, yeah, she's doing incredibly well. And I have to give an honourable mention as well. Another centre-back, Karen Hills, who was part of that successful FA Cup winning side, is now the manager at Charlton. So there's a lot of things coming out of our conversation in terms of old players coming back. They want to drive success. And whether she's given enough credit that she deserves for the consistency that she's given since Thomas Sandgaard made the women's team professional, she has driven the club forward and overcome a lot of obstacles and hurdles as those growing pains, I think, that comes with trying to be a professional outfit. And they currently sit top of the Women's Championship, incredibly competitive division. I saw her yesterday after the 1-1 draw at the Valley against Sunderland, and she was a bit disappointed because she felt like they should have won that game. They were all over Sunderland. But if we can get promoted to the Women's Super League, the highest tier in the women's game, that would be huge for the club. It really, really would. So hopefully this is the season to do so, because the thing about women's football as well for me is that it's a catalyst for playing and getting young girls like your daughter involved in football. And that doesn't necessarily have to be playing. It can be roles on the sidelines as a coach, physio. It can be roles off of the pitch as well. So you know, I'm really proud that the women's team are given such equal standing. And if they weren't, I don't know whether I would be as involved as I am.
It's a great, I mean, Sandgaard obviously knew what he was doing. As a business decision, it made sense because it's a growing market. You know, the women's game is getting bigger and bigger, whereas the men's has constantly got issues that we're dealing with, and with you know, Saudi Arabia League and all that sort of stuff is causing, you know, where are the players going, all that sort of thing. Do you think this is, again, I'm asking you a question that I probably shouldn't ask direct to you. I've got you here. So how far away are we? And do you think that there should be more from Charlton TV in terms of punditry coming from those kind of players and from the ladies game?
I think it's really well integrated in terms. One of the things I really like about Charlton TV is our sort of 45-minute pre-game show, because it gives us opportunity to look ahead to the 90 minutes that's about to unfold. But we also have opportunities to cover other elements of the club, and the women are very consistently a part of that. And we're able to showcase results. We're able to showcase interviews and so on. And the club's social media channels are really, really well populated. The club's well marketed. I think there's scope to grow. I think not the difficulty, but the FA have their own sort of strategy around it, and they have a platform called FA Player where quite a lot of the Women's Championship football is streamed. I've actually commentated for the FA on Charlton games. So I feel like the service is well provided, but, you know, the hope would be that it will grow. And I think the most important thing for women's football in particular is that it's sustainable, because, you know, as was shown decades ago when it got cut, it has to try and wash its face a little bit. So I definitely think there's obviously room for it to improve and enhance. But I think overall, when you're thinking about Charlton TV, like ultimately as a service, it has to wash its face. And I know it's very, very well regarded by supporters, but I suppose how does that translate onto the pieces of paper that are in front of a board? I don't know, but hopefully, you know, it'd be great to get more involved, and you know, maybe that will come to fruition. I think it's great seeing them play at the Valley more again with the new ownership coming in. They've had many games at the Valley, so I hope that continues, because that for me is something that is within the club's, you know, power and remit to do quite easily.
Absolutely. And I think it's it bridges that gap, doesn't it? And Kerbishley is always talking about. And the nice thing is, I mean, I know there hasn't been too many, you know, guest pundits on that have been from the female team, but Kerbs is always talking about it. He's involved quite heavily, obviously, yourself. I know they've integrated the Sparrows Lane and the all three, all the teams use that. So I think in turn, I think we're doing good. But like you said, there's always space to do more. Yeah, it's an interesting and long may it continue, and fingers crossed we don't go down again. They just get rid of it. That would be nice.
Yeah.
Who have you gone for as your right back?
So I have gone for Chris Solly. Okay. Yeah, so I wanted to include Chris Solly because it kind of reflects on a point made earlier really about players that spend that amount of time at a football club. I just think it's becoming a dying breed of player. And I'm also, you know, I love football, and hopefully that's come across in this podcast, not just Charlton, not just Gillingham, but the whole football pyramid. And I've grown up in South East London on the border of Kent, and the non-league community around here is thriving, and I know that Chris went and played a part at Ebbsfleet as well, and so I just felt like it was nice to have a little nod to you know, a player that's really contributed to football in the local area. So, you know, 10 years, was it?
Yeah, 301 appearances. I mean, it's massive. And he had, I mean, 301 appearances for us. He had six for the England under 16s, nine for the England under 17s, and then another 92 for Ipswich. I mean, you look at players with a long career, Chris has got to be up there. My only thing with Chris, and I don't know all the ins and outs, but Lyle Taylor gets a lot of stick for not coming back when that lockdown happened. And Chris had the same thing where he didn't, you know, play to the end of that contract. I'm not saying I just think for me that left a little bit of a bad taste in my mouth, which was filled with lovely, nice stuff for a very long time. And he wasn't the same player that Lyle Taylor was. He wasn't going to knock in 100 goals, you know, 5-6 goals for us to keep us up. But I do wonder with that, what was the story there and what happened? I'd love to know more about that.
Yeah, I think it comes back to that thing as well, of those decisions. And being a footballer is something that I think we probably all dream of doing, but it comes with other parts that don't necessarily get displayed as much, you know, the role and influence of agents. And, you know, it can be a bit mercenary as well. You know, footballers can be a bit exposed to people that aren't always there. And I'm not saying this, I'm not aligning this with Chris at all. I'm just talking sort of more generally speaking now, that you talk to any managers and people involved in football and they talk about the role and influence of agents growing. And I just think sometimes things look like a decision or something might be outward speculation, a transfer move. And sometimes there is a bit more to it that goes on behind the scenes that people just never know about. And like I said, I'm not alluding to anything with Chris, but I know that that was just such a weird, trying time for everyone. And, you know, it's another subject for another podcast. I'm sure that we could delve into the details of, you know, how players are looked after and those really, really difficult situations. But I also think with Chris as well, he's a player that I've read a lot about and seen a lot about in terms of how he used to engage with supporters. And he just seemed to, I never interviewed him, I never worked with him. But I like that about professional footballers, and it's not a prerequisite that they make time for supporters. Some players genuinely have crippling anxiety and confidence when it comes to doing things like public speaking and interviews. Players that you wouldn't believe can all of a sudden put a microphone in front of them, or, you know, they just genuinely feel uncomfortable. It's not that they're being rude or anything like that, but I love to see those interactions. And I just get the impression with Chris that he was someone that always had time for supporters as well. So I just thought he'd be another good character to add to this this crew that I've assembled.
That's a really good point, actually. And I'm going to do something I haven't done, which is introduce your next player for you, because it's a player that I thought that exactly that about. He seems so shy. And you know what? This is a muted video, but you picked Jez Rakczaki in your midfield. And he just looked, from that first interview, he looked so scared and nervous, and he wanted to be anywhere other than talking to the media. Yeah, to me. while I play the video, what do you do in that situation? I'm gonna have to unmute.
So interesting you say that, actually, because I was talking to Miles about it recently, and he actually said something quite similar in terms of when you're a young player, whether you've come through Charlton's academy, whatever academy it is, that's nothing can quite prepare you. I mean, look at him, raw talent. You can be the most gifted, talented, do all of the talking with your feet, but making that step up into men's senior football, that changing room environment, is really challenging and daunting. And of course, it does come with responsibilities off the pitch, which, how do the players get prepared for that? You know, you can perhaps do media training or, you know, practice and watch other players, but, you know, there's nothing like building that confidence up. And with Jez and a couple of the younger players, I know it's something that was really, really daunting for them, but it was, you know, part of their responsibility and something that the more that we would do it, the better they would be at it, if that makes sense. And I think Miles is certainly an example that springs to my mind, because he's a player I've interviewed a few times now, from that sort of debut goal moment to interviewing him at Cray last week, where actually I thought he came, I felt like his personality really shone through. And that's the point, is that when you're a club TV, you have hopefully the opportunity to make that individual feel comfortable, that, you know, they're not talking to an outlet that's looking for, I'm not looking for clickbait. I'm not looking for something that's, you know, going to be peddled or, you know, used for, you know, morning radio shows or something like that. But I felt with that interview with Miles, like he really just kind of, there was no guard there at all. And we just got to see what a sort of lovely, humble, ambitious, competitive young man he is. Because again, these are teenagers we're talking about. We watch them play football and we think, you know, they're grown up, but they've got so much growing to do, and they still articulate themselves in such a great way. So yeah, Jez certainly, you know, did all of his talking with his feet, and a really humble young man. And I think probably, again, certainly in the time that I've been involved with Charlton, live, watching a player live, like electrifying, game-changing, won us more points than I think any player in recent years, individually I'm speaking. You know, the way he turned games for Charlton was quite incredible.
He, I mean, he played throughout, 15 goals, I see, and he's already had 8 appearances for Palace. I think, just going back to that point about, you know, interviewing these young guys, the dynamic with footballers is so odd, because I have the same relationship with players that I did with when I was 8, which is that I just see them and I idolise them. You're idolising people who are half your age, and, you know, there's fans, my dad's in his 70s, he's watching these players, and, you know, when you see him score, you can see the sparkle in his eye, like, God, I love that kid, and you kind of bring up. But how can you, that's too much to put on this 17-year-old lad who's just started earning more money than I'll probably earn in a lifetime. Maybe not at Charlton level, but you know what I mean, in terms of Premier League money. But it's such a dynamic, and I think that's one of your biggest assets, is being able to make these guys feel comfortable in a situation where they can just ignore that kind of pressure and just get their point across in a way that isn't going to upset anyone. They don't have to worry about the legal battle or anything like that. But is there any kind of media training that goes on? Are you aware of anything? Are you being part of
it? I believe, you know, and that comes, you know, it's very much a team effort with preparing these young players. And I think it's quite apparent to anyone that follows Charlton that the academy is one of the most, you know, successful, and they develop players, but they also develop really well-rounded young men. And again, you look at the areas that we're in Southeast London, there could have been many different routes. You know, there's lots of temptation. There can be lots of bad influences growing up in this area of London. And I think the academy and the community trust has done a really good job in providing a different outlet for people. So, you know, that they're prepared for life on the pitch and off of it as well. So I do know that they get media training and media support, and the club has a fantastic comms team that ensures, and sometimes, you know, you have to push, and I'm not going to name names because it'd be really unfair for me to do so, but I know there's been a couple where, you know, we've had to push and get them to overcome perhaps the challenges they have with their confidence, because they're incredibly talented footballers, and when they inevitably move on from Charlton, the club wants to make sure that they're prepared as best as possible, and, you know, all of them handle it really, really well. I spoke to Mika Mbeck last week after he scored at Craig Valley, 17 years old, so, you know, assured and confident, and just
came across so well. He was like, he's ready. He felt really for it, didn't he?
100%. And again, for me, in the very back of my mind, I want anyone I interview to come across well. You know, I want to give them a platform where they feel like they can express themselves, where they can, you know, answer some questions they probably know are floating around a little bit, and ultimately, you know, when they are put in the shop window, I don't think any football club in the Premier League that's looking at a Miles Leeburn or a TC or a Jez Rezaki is not watching those interviews. They are an important part of the character of the person that you're going to invest your money in. And I think, you know, I know it's Palace, so it's really difficult to say, but, you know, Charlton are reliant on that loan system. And I know Dean Holden spoke about it a lot. But, you know, if you want to get top players, and you've got to come in and look after them. And I think with Jez, we did a really good job of helping a young player flourish and grow and develop week in, week out at a really important stage in their career. So we will have built that position of trust with Palace that if they have anyone else like it, I know it's not the situation we want to be in, we'd far rather it be the other way around, but yeah. You know, that is part of the business and the mechanics of football. And again, it's something that Brownie used to say to me a lot about, that kind of loan system and how good it was that, you know, we had a player like that and he won all the, you know, he won all the awards that he deserved to, and he managed to do what many, many others could not, and that's to get Charlton supporters to fall in love with a Palace player. So you did great, and I didn't lie. And you know, I know there was a bit about that, but you know, that's all just rubbish. He was fully, you know, deserving of every bit of credit, and goes back to Palace a better player.
Yeah, it's a silly thing that we do joke about, but I mean, it's amazing that someone like that can come in, and yeah, like you said, the development there is incredible. It's another feather in our cap that we're able to do that, and yourself and the team are a massive part of that, because like you said, giving them that platform is an amazing thing to be able to do. Going across the midfield, we've got pretty much a pretty well-established midfield here. Who do you want to go for?
Yeah, I was going to say that in terms of tactics, this would look a very sort of, I don't know, defensive heavy, but let's go for Johnny Jackson next.
So I think, yeah, this one's muted as well. The reason I like these clips is because you've got these two goals that he scored against the two Sheffield clubs back to back. And then I don't know if you saw it there, the worst goal that's ever been scored in football, a sort of P-roller from a million miles away, just ends up in the back of the net there. But Johnny Jackson, I mean, did you overlap in terms of your involvement with Charlton TV and when he came in? How was that?
Yeah. So Johnny was the first interview I did for Charlton TV. So, you know, there's many reasons. Again, club leader legend is Johnny Jackson. But for me, he's kind of even more, you know, special, so to speak, because it's a funny old world football. It's a really small world. And, you know, I will always remember that first interview. I've done God knows how many since, but, you know, that first interview with Johnny, where it felt like a massive opportunity for me. And again, I sort of knew and was conscious of the fact that I was a new voice. You know, who is this? And I completely understand that. You know, you get no real introduction. It's just kind of, you know, you take the opportunities when they're given. But I felt like also it was a bit of an opportunity for him because he was assistant at the time. And I just felt like we were both sort of at stages in our careers where this interview was actually a bit more than just a random Papa John's interview. For me, it was a chance to sort of showcase a different skill set to the guys at the club. And for Johnny, it was the first time that Charlton supporters really heard him speak in that coaching managerial way. And, you know, I wish I'd worked with less Charlton managers in the time that I have. But, you know, he was always, you know, incredibly gracious, a really great guy. And I freelance for other broadcasters as well. And actually my first game for TalkSport was at AFC Wimbledon, and my first post-match for TalkSport was at AFC Wimbledon. And Johnny saw me sort of, there was a real mosh pit of journalists like all fighting to talk to him. And he actually massively went out of his way to come and talk to me. And I was able to get a really good quality interview, which again just helped relieve my nerves. He wouldn't know any of that. That's just the kind of guy that he is. But I thought, another person that I really like, a manager I think's got a super bright future. I think he falls into that category of young managers that, you know, need time. There has to, when you appoint a manager like Johnny Jackson, there has to be time to let them evolve and develop. And unfortunately, football, not just at Charlton Athletic, but again, across the whole pyramid, it just doesn't seem to be something that young coaches get afforded. And it's a real concern for me, because I think there's a lot of talented managers that just will not get the opportunities, you know, like a Curbs. You know, Curbs nowadays, I don't know, I've never asked him the question, maybe I will if I get the opportunity to do so, but does he think he would have the opportunity to have the career he had? Sir Alex Ferguson, no chance coming into the game now. No chance. So I just thought he was a fantastic player. I like the synergy I see between his managerial style and his playing style. And again, from what I sort of could see, he was a really good manager. And I can see AFC Wimbledon have been doing really well. And yeah, so he just would do well in my midfield, I think.
Yeah, I mean, they're very versatile. Sorry, I'm scoring a couple of free kicks there that are amazing. I think you're right. He's a victim of the time and the ownership we had. I don't know if he would have done any better under the current ownership, but it did seem like there was a bit of a... I don't think there was ever plans to give Johnny the time he wanted. I think he came in, did so well, and then had to be given the permanent job. And then when things started to go a bit south, it was a chance for the old Sandgaard to bring in someone that he wanted, for worse, obviously. But the best thing about, I think, Jackson's ever done was that cover of Wonderwall on social media. I mean, that was a beautiful... What a handsome man. Again, you've got some good-looking players in this team, I've got to be honest.
I know. I've inadvertently produced a really, really good-looking starting 11 here.
And I mean, even next to... I mean, but yeah, Jackson, again, what a head of hair. But yeah, let's go on. Who do you want to go for next?
Across the well, now you said head of hair, I've got to go for George Dobson, haven't I? He's got a good barnet.
Yeah. Back to Fraser. Out to Morgan, looking to deliver the ball into the box. It's a deep one. Morgan, Dobson gets it with a header. Oh, it's there! Oh, George Dobson has levelled it up for Charlton with the last seconds of the game. Quite extraordinary. It looked like we were dead and buried. Charlton had other ideas. Chucks and EK did superbly well. Charlton were patient to get the cross in. It was Albie Morgan who delivered it. And George Dobson heads his back over Christian Walton, who couldn't get there. And quite remarkably, the Addicts are back on level terms.
That's quite appalling from Ipswich Town, to be honest. However, let's not worry about them. George Dobson tells you everything you need to know about us getting a result today. The fella barely ever gets in the opposition box.
I love that. I could watch that again and again and again. That is my, I'm going to say it, my favourite moment. One of my favourite moments at the Valley since working for Charlton TV.
So you were on the side of the pitch for that?
So I was pitch side. And so I knew that my task was going to have to be interviewing Ben Garner after that. And I was actually stood right behind where the incident that led to his sending off. And I actually really sympathised with him. He, the fourth just wouldn't speak to him. And it was all just a little bit farcical. But I did think to myself, oh, God, I hope the boys respond to this. Because it felt very much like a moment. Like, Ben was very shrewd, a very intelligent football manager. And I think he knew exactly what he was doing in terms of, you know, the iconic exit. And what I tend to do... again, I'm quite superstitious and I know football's never really over until it's over. But once we begin to get to the 85, 90 minute mark, I begin to get into my head, like, what I want to ask. Like, what do I want to speak to the manager about? So I'll begin to, like, maybe make some notes or jot down key points. Well, this game, I went from, well done, you've got the draw, to you haven't. And in the end, I just didn't do anything. And then the interview with Ben was the one where I had nothing. I just think my first question was like, Ben, how do we even like dissect that? Because you had to, you know, accept that for what it was. But George Dobson for me had to come into my starting 11 because he joined the club at a similar time that I did. And there hasn't been a lot of consistency in that spell. And he has just, you know, he has just been a rock for Charlton for such a long time. You know, there's so much to say about what he gives on the pitch, but I like his kind of quieter style of leadership as well. You know, I just think he's a really great character. Again, I don't think I've interviewed him too many times. It's a bit random sometimes, like the players you find yourself interviewing him a lot. But I just like the way he goes about captaining the football club. I think he's great, and his qualities and his stats speak for themselves in League One. And, you know, he will cover any blade of grass for the football club. So, he had to get into my starting 11. And I know he made 100 appearances relatively recently. And I hope I get the impression he's only 26 as well. Like, I just thought he was older, but I think that's more a reflection of me just thinking I'm younger. But I hope that he can prove to be a player that goes on to, you know, I would love to see him end his career at Charlton. I think that could be, you know, a possibility if, you know, he's handed a contract extension or whatever, and if he wants that, of course. But
yeah,
I get the impression he does. He seems like very much a Charlton man. So yeah, I just think he's awesome.
God, I hope so. I mean, I love that clip for so many different reasons. One is Scott Frazier's having a massive go at the referee when he passes the ball. The ball comes in, the header's unbelievable. I mean, the way it loops over and goes in the back of net. But George's celebration is one of the worst things I've ever seen. Knees up, head down, arms like this. Oh. I've never seen anything like it. And he's, for someone with, he's obviously a good looking boy, great head of hair. His posture on the pitch, it's like him and Jason Pearce are the only people I've seen. I've got posture like that as well. So if
you're you're making me want to put my shoulders back. Yeah. But I love Chucks and EK in that clip. I don't know if many people notice it, but Chucks like literally just falls to the ground.
Yeah.
Just floored. It was just unbelievable. It's just, it was one of those 90 minutes where, you know, as a football fan, success is rarely a given, like particularly our part of the football pyramid. You know, you're not going to be following European football. You know, that's why I love the FA Cup and competitions like that. And even though that was a point, I mean, that will be the best point that we've ever earned. It was just absolutely incredible. And look where Ipswich have gone to now. But and he's been contributing to, I mean, that's a really well-taken header, but the goals he scored this season have been...
Well, that's what I was going to say. He came in as a bit of a terrier. He just won the ball, laid off. The goal and the assist for May against Cray, it was like watching Paul Scholes. I mean, he's added this level to his game that I never thought we'd see from him, where he's hitting it from well outside the box freely. He's playing amazing balls. I mean, I'm glad you said it, because it was going to be my question. Do you think we keep him? And God, I think watching his development means that you'd think that there's, where else could he go? I mean, he can go to the Championship, but would he have that? Is it going to be as big of a, is he going to grow with a club like that? I mean, fingers crossed we get hold of him and push for the playoffs. But...
And the other thing as well, Sam, is that I think it's a really good point you make there about him improving, because when you are a player, like, he's had to do a lot in the last few seasons in really difficult circumstances.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
we talk about what it's like following a club, but for players, that sort of changing of the guard in terms of managers, different philosophies, when you're at the heart of midfield and everything comes through you, like, he has just made it look so easy in terms of the instructions and the job that he's been asked to do. And in previous years, and again, this isn't to sound critical of any other manager that's been or any other style of play that we've had, it's not. But he's had to carry a load and do a really defensive role. Whereas I actually think, rather subtly, since Michael Appleton's come in, we are seeing a slightly different style of his game or a different part of his game. And I think you can see bits that have been worked on to make, like, I think he's a very well-rounded midfielder anyway, but a lot gets said about the crunching tackles and the sliding interventions. But there is a lot more to his game than that. And I think we're just seeing that a lot more. And again, I know Scott Frazier is kind of like our creative, you know, technically gifted. But I think McGrandles and Dobson, I mean, we're just now seeing that competition, aren't we? Watson and Dobson.
Yeah. Oh, Watson's been a revelation, I think, given that extra spice. I mean, I think every manager that's come in, maybe apart from Appleton, I'm not sure, has dropped Dobson and played someone else. And then he's just played his way back in. So like you said, overcoming that adversity, it's probably made him a better player in that as well.
That's his character. And when you're in and around football for, you know, like I've been for 10 years now, like, that's not a given that a footballer can get that kind of feedback, or to have that, you know, to have that being dropped and to work and graft their way back in. You know, that is testament to his character. And I guess the last word I want to say about him is that he just epitomizes the word professionalism in every single sense.
It does show through. I think one of your players you picked as a striker has got it slightly more, but I think Dobson's been that one player that has connected with the fans over this kind of hard time. It's been, like you said, the constant, but also the player who wants to play for the shirt as well. You've got one more player in midfield. Go for it.
Yeah, so I have gone, and I think you said earlier that he might have made a lot of people's 11s. It's Scott Parker.
Jensen. Newell. Parker fancies another dip. Oh, look at that! Did he take a deflection on the way through? Doesn't matter much for John. It's 2-2. Scott Parker's got them both. Now take a look at this. Does it deflect? No, he just bends it.
Does it deflect? Honestly, no. I think for me, I wanted to put another academy graduate into the squad for obvious reasons, because I think, you know, anyone that follows Charlton and supports Charlton, the academy plays a really big part in that. And I know that a lot was made about his departure and Curbs sort of talk about it. It's actually, but I've interviewed Curbs a lot about Scott, and you know, I think he sort of reviews it a little bit differently now that there's been time. And I know it wasn't the nicest of endings, but any former teammate, or, you know, in the Charlton TV lounge, I've been fortunate enough to interview a lot of legends, and they just talk about he was just another level on the training ground. And I always think that's the sign of, you know, you kind of, you get your good players and then you get your special players. And when teammates sort of say that, you know, that's a really a big testament to him, and you know what he produced, and the way that he, you know, stood out to the point that he eventually did get his move. And perhaps again was that generation of player where the mechanics of the game started to transition from the old school and the old school values, where you know, a manager like Curbs would have probably expected and wanted him to stay and play and train the same, but the dynamic between, you know, the player power and started to change a little bit. But definitely, you know, wanted him in my 11.
I've said, I mean, like I said, I think he's one of the few 100% choices. I've said a lot, because I think from a fan's point of view, loved him so much. Like, I felt so lucky to have him. He was just this massive fish in such a small pond. And then you look at where he's, I mean, I thought he was going to go on and captain England and, you know, take us to the Champions League. And then from for it to go there to where it did go, it's quite easy to see why I'd be upset. But the one thing you can't take away is just how good he was. He was an unbelievable player. Like you said, come up through the ranks, and he's a great advert for Charlton. But I wasn't disappointed when he got sacked after 13 games for Club Bruges. That's all I'm going to say. But no, he's an amazing guy, and I hope he does. I hope he does bounce back. I'm sure he will. Two strikers, one that you know really, really well, I imagine, and one that maybe is a bit before, yeah, came in before your time. Who do you want to go for first?
Let's go for the one I know a little less, and that's Darren Bent.
And four for Bent, and he's onside again. Could this be two? Got stuck up behind him. Oh, how confident was that? I thought the chance had gone. He knew it hadn't. Another goal for Darren Bent, and Charlton's lead is double. What a start he has had to Premiership football. Onside, clearly. Ledley King in the middle was playing him on. Oh, it was a beauty.
Just an incredible centre forward. Darren Bent, I think, just had so many different attributes to his game. And for Charlton, he was, for one season in the Premier League, the highest scoring Englishman. Like, that is not easy. And to do that in a Charlton shirt, I just felt like he needed to be in the starting 11. And of course, there's a media thread throughout my starting 11. You know, he's a colleague on Talk Sport and, you know, now does a lot of that. And it's always great to hear his stories and give his insight and share his expertise, because being a centre forward is probably one of the hardest jobs. I think being a goalkeeper is the loneliest. I would love to be a centre back because I quite enjoy that. But a striker just carries a different sort of, it's the high and low position, yeah. I think, and you know, the amount of goals that he scored for the club in a real golden era, for a fan my age, I think that's just, you know, he's just quite iconic. And I suspect for a lot of Charlton supporters sort of in their late 20s, early 30s, he would have probably been the poster boy growing up, you know, the player that would just enchant you, get you on the edge of your seat. He's the player that I just recall when I was sat next to my granddad watching Match of the Day highlights would always be the star man. So there's a bit of nostalgic reason why he's in there as well.
I mean, he was amazing. I mean, 68 appearances, 31 goals, and then he goes on and does some great things. We've said it on the podcast before, you know, it's a travesty that he wasn't picked to play in that England team. What he's seen, he comes across as such a good guy. Have you met him? I know you said like...
Yeah. I have fleetingly sort of in TalkSport headquarters, and not enough to say, oh, I work for Charlton and to talk about Charlton. But, you know, yeah, just seems exactly how he is. And again, that's I think, the best trait of a broadcaster and the likes of Brownie Scott and Darren is that they're exactly the same on air as they are off air. And yeah, just seemed like a really nice chap. All my colleagues speak so highly of working with him there as well. So I think that's really nice. And I think it's a hard thing when you're in those positions sometimes to, you know, reveal those experiences that you've had. And I think he always does it really, really well, delicately with humour on TalkSport as well. And I think obviously he's probably so busy. We've never really had him back. I've never interviewed him for Charlton TV, but, you know, fingers crossed. I've got obviously the most awkward derby in the FA Cup to come in my house. But, you know, should we progress further? I'd like to think that he was a pundit that might come back. And because it was nice to see Danny Murphy at Cray Valley, of course. So, yeah, he's doing really, really well now. So it's great to see.
Yeah, it is. It's nice to see his life after football because, you know, again, another player that I think... he wasn't wrong in moving at all. I mean, he went at the right time for good money and all that sort of thing. But I just don't feel like, I feel like he could have done a lot more. Not if he, and not to do with picking the choices better. I think he just should have got picked in that England team. And then you would have really seen something special. I mean, he did well for Spurs. I love that clip though, because he's playing against Ledley King. I mean, that goal that he scores,
yeah.
There was nothing. He was quick. He had technical ability. He could sit back in a 10 roll, push forward on the edge of the line. And I think the same could be for your last choice. Who have you gone for as your final striker?
So my number 9 is Alfie May. Such a talent. Like, I think, I don't want to be too hyperbolic and too dramatic, but I think he could become sort of a modern day legend for Charlton. He came with good goal scoring prowess. But you know what? The reason why I really wanted him in my 11 is because I just love the joy that he has when he plays football.
He's always got a smile on his face, hasn't he?
Yeah. Just always has a smile on his face. I never see any sign of poor body language. And again, I think that could be quite easy when you're a centre forward because you are obviously so sort of transfixed on putting the ball in the back of the net and sometimes games don't go for you. And I know the Bolton game was a really, really difficult one for him because of the position he was asked to play and because of the manner in which the defence, you know, it was just a tough game. But then second half, you know, he just really dug deep and it wasn't our day that day. And Bolton, I've said it for 2 seasons in a row now, the best side I have seen live in League One. But I just love the joy. And I don't think it's easy now to see players just that it's just so clear, the energy and the unbridled joy. I also like his story coming from non-league. I think that contributes to how you can see him relish it. Because when I think he was a scaffolder. You know, wake up at 5 a.m, do a day's work, then go and play football and still love it. You know, I just get that impression that... it's all a bit of a dream and he doesn't take it for granted. And I'm not saying that footballers do take it for granted, but I think if that's your journey, there's just something you appreciate all the more. Very special person. Haven't interviewed him, I don't think, ever. So I don't know him. I've never interviewed him, but I just, that's the thing. I feel like I know him because personality shines through his football.
That's such a good sentiment. I think that as well. I mean, in terms of how long he's been at the club, I would have said he's been there 10 years. I mean, he came in and he seemed to embody. And this is where this is what I mean about I don't want to think that Charlton's something extra special, because I imagine that a lot of fans have the same thing. But he did embody everything that we love as Charlton fans. He worked hard. He enjoyed his football. He showed his emotion when he scored and when he didn't score and when we lost it. He always seems to want to play for us. And that's something that I don't, that there's definitely players that we've had recently where they haven't come across like that. And he just seemed to, I think Dobson's been the best of it, embodying that kind of Mr. Charlton, someone you can relate to and someone who shows that passion on the pitch. But I think he's a bit quieter in his leadership, whereas Alfie May, you slap the captain's armband on him tomorrow and he's a talker, he leads by example, he's a terrier, he works so hard, and he's got this amazing technical ability. I mean, that goal that we just saw against Cray, shown against Cray, the way he brings that ball down is unbelievable. And I've not seen that since Lyle Taylor. I don't think we've had a player like that who's that got that natural goal scoring ability. And he seems to be able to, Michael Appleton just dropped him back into a number 10. You're thinking, why would you play someone like that who's that quick and can get in behind players? But he's picking up the ball and he's working, he's scoring more goals now than he did in the first five games.
He's got that real invaluable quality of having a very, very good footballing brain that is 2-3 phases of play ahead, passes ahead than everybody else. But the tenacity and the instinct to also finish off moves as well. Yeah. And I think it's worth noting that, like, he didn't have the best start. I think it was like 3 or 4 games until he scored, and it was in the penalty spot.
Yeah.
And so again, that to me speaks volumes of a character that sees out those tougher times. And there's always them in football, whether it's injury, whether again, it's the toll that comes with the physicality, like the scheduling is tough. And I know we would all switch places like that tomorrow to call being a footballer our job, but it does come with a lot of stuff that doesn't always get seen in terms of it takes a lot mentally. And I can imagine for him, because there was a lot around the summer, wasn't there, about where he was going to move to, and Gillingham put a lot of their eggs in an Alfie May shaped basket, and look at how, you know, they're struggling for goals. But he saw it out, and that goal felt like a big moment. And I think again, with a player like him, it does like kind of remind me of the likes of like a Phil Foden, of guys like, I'm talking big names here, in terms of their best football is played when they're just not thinking.
Yeah.
And like, as soon as he got that penalty, and now like later on in the season, we're seeing that flurry of goals where everything he touches turns to gold, is because that transition's been made now, whatever role he's being asked to play. And I just, you know, I really hope that continues. We've got a big, you know, we've got a big important period coming up now. You know, I think every football fan, or certainly, you know, the managers, they look at the period we're about to go into. It's a really pivotal part of the season, and keeping him fit and keeping him sharp, because again, I think he always looks so sharp, and it can be taken for granted, but that sharpness is it's priceless to our team, really. And if we've got aspirations to make playoffs, or, you know, who knows better, his goals are going to be completely, you know, a part of that.
Yeah, it's going to be because of him. And I mean, if Corey Blackett goes in the window, and you know, if Chucks comes back for injury, that'll be amazing. But I don't think we're going to add to the squad up front. He's got to keep fit. And the nice thing with him, he does always seem to want to play. I'd imagine he'd play with one leg if he had to. It's so surprising you saying never interview him, because I feel like I've seen so much of him, but he does seem to get involved. He did the day with Alfie May, in the life of Alfie May on social media. And those little bits make a big difference and really help you connect to players. And it's a big thing we've got now that we didn't, that wasn't there when I was growing up. It would be the Shoot or Match magazines and that kind of thing. So having and making good use of the social media is really important. They do seem to be doing that. So let's have a look at your team. I've put it in a 4-4-2 formation and sort of had a guess at how you would lay this out. How are you feeling about it now, looking at it on paper?
I think that's a decent team. I'd start them against Carlisle, for sure.
Do you know what's funny? Because you say, you know, you've said, like we said, you've gone for your mates, and that's absolutely fair enough. But Minto, Brown, they don't look out of place in that team. And I think in terms of all-roundedness, rather than you trying to force players in, which is definitely what a few of the other guests have done, and playing really narrow, it looks like we've actually got a nice sort of balance to that team, I'd say.
I would say, like I say, my heart definitely ruled over my head. And there were definitely some other honourable mentions. Enia Luku came close to starting as well. But yeah, for me as a football fan, it's all about values. And like I've said to you at the very start, I've been in a blue and red household all my life. So winning trophies and loads of success hasn't always been a part. There's been glimpses of it. But for me, all I ever want is a team that tries, and more importantly, a football club that stands for something on and off the pitch. And I just think all of these resemble qualities and are part of the history and culture of Charlton Athletic Football Club.
Yeah, no, I agree. I do agree. Apart from Parker, I think you're absolutely right. With regard to, my last question I always ask is, who from the current squad would you swap out for one of your fantasy 11? You've already got two in there. Is there anyone else you would swap out in the current lineup?
Good question. I think I would maybe Miles Leeburn could get into this team, in terms of, I think he's a young player with loads and loads of potential in terms of how you would want to build a centre forward. He has got every single attribute. He's got the height. He's developed the physicality. I've seen players target him so many times. I've seen players target him so many times, and he's really developed and grown. And I think he's got the potential to really climb the pyramid. So if I was going to be shrewd, I'd get him in my team so I could make a load of money off of him.
Yeah, I think it's a very good shout. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a different conversation we're having now about the first 11 than we would have done at the beginning of the season. But there's a couple of players in there. Dobson and May fit into that team roughly. It wouldn't surprise me if in a couple of years' time we are talking about Leeburn in that kind of bracket as well. I think that's a solid team, Charles. I think you've done really well there. In terms of what happens today, because obviously we're playing Sutton today.
I've got an evening off this evening, so I won't be there tonight. But obviously I'll be following along. And again, I think it's just sort of, I find it hard to keep up with all the games sometimes. I was there at Cray last week. I'll be covering Carlisle on Saturday in the studio, and I'm also going to be in the studio on Tuesday night for the game against Cheltenham. So that'll be great, because I think with the Tuesday evening games, we have the ability to stream across the UK, which I know is always really well received for fans that have maybe lived in the area but moved further afield or have work commitments and stuff like that. They can sort of still watch it. So I'm really looking forward to both of those games. I think, again, it's another really important week. What is it, 4 games in the space of like 10 days or something?
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
very, very busy time. So squad rotation is going to be important. So, be interesting to see how I spoke to him off Michael Appleton after the game, and he said he's going to be taking it really seriously. And I actually think that game's quite nice in terms of keeping the players fit and sharp after having a weekend off. So,
I heard Murphy kind of speak about that after the game against Cray, and it makes complete sense. Yeah, it's a bit of a blessing. I forgot to ask, sorry, who would you be your manager? Who's going to be, and what a big surprise this is going to be?
King Kerbs, Alan Kerbsley, of course. Not only because, you know, I want to keep him sweet in the studio, but what more do you add to, the, you know, his name's emblazoned on the stadium for a reason. Again, just the different circumstances, his start as a manager, the move back to the Valley, you know, he had to do a lot. And again, of all the people, he's probably one of the ones I've interviewed the most, and what they had to deal with, you know, and the porter cabins they used to work in, and the characters he had to manage. And every single player I've ever interviewed talks about the qualities that they had as individuals and how good Kerbs was at having those individuals but blending them into a squad. So you know, and I've got to put on record as well how much I've really enjoyed working with every single manager that I have at Charlton. Like I say, sadly, a lot of them, in the sense that there's been a lot of rotation in the last 2 years, but all really, really good guys, really good people. So although there's been inconsistencies, the club does always look to recruit good people, whether that then reflects in the ways people want football to be played and results aren't, you know, there's so many circumstances that go into winning a game of football and doing it consistently. But I've been very blessed to get to interview a lot of really good managers.
I'm a nightmare because I'm so fickle. I'm not fickle when they leave, but everyone that comes in, I fall in love with. I fell in love with Jackson straight away, obviously. Ben Garner, when he came in, seemed to be such a tactician and good guy. And then even Nigel Adkins gets a bit of bad press now, but you couldn't not love the guy for those videos he does. And Dean Holden being in the pub afterwards and seeming to really connect with the fans. And now Michael Mappinson, who seemed a bit standoffish but has delivered. You can't, who do you not side with? But yeah, I think in terms of managers, I don't think I'm too young to remember Jimmy Seed, obviously, but in terms of Kovacic, he felt like he was there from when I was started going till I went to university. And he really did feel like a father figure and a consistent presence in the club, which was the biggest part of my life. So yeah, how could you not?
And it tells you how much he loves the club, because every Saturday he's there despite the Blackpool Tunnel. Which
it's so unbelievable, isn't it?
Loves them.
Where can is there anything anywhere people can check you out, follow stuff you're doing, or is it just
So just kind of the normal Instagram, Twitter. You know, I do like to share where I'm going often, you know, because most home games I'm covering Charlton, but I cover a lot of football across the pyramid as well. So yeah, if anyone is interested or wants to see the behind the scenes snacks, I promise on Saturday I will share those, Sam. I will try and remember to share the photos of the snacks and bring some up, because it's getting to mince pie season now. So maybe I'll be extra nice and treat the boys over the next week.
Lovely stuff. And we talked about merch. Do you want to show off? Yeah, I've had a couple of glimpses of the earrings. Yeah.
So I don't know if you can see them in screen, but I am wearing some Charlton earrings that were kindly gifted to me by a lovely couple who I met at the recent open day at the club, which again was just a testament to how many people. I don't think any of us expected to be there for 3 hours, but it was amazing. And they were made at the workshop of Nigel's Cool Knickknacks Limited. So they were very kindly gifted to me. They're really nice, really comfy, and they're just a little nod to Charlton. I might wear them in the studio on Saturday. Keep your eyes peeled. But yeah, they're my little bit of Charlton merch.
They look very festive. I mean, we're lucky. It's very festive, isn't it? They look great. Charlotte, thank you so much. Thank you for coming down, spending so much time talking about your dream team. It's been amazing, and the insights behind the scenes. Yeah, just a massive thank you, and wish you all the best. Can't wait to see next episode of Charlton TV.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a real pleasure, and thank you for your kind words about Charlton TV as well. We'll pass that on to the team, because, you know, I hope that Charlton TV will be around to be that